social relations that, and so I
And what is his general approach these days? I mean, is it close to the official line, or is it sort of more open?
Hello? One of these.
Hello? Hello?
They can stay on the whole time, but... So here, where is better to keep it? I don't know. You have maybe experience on this.
Yeah. You ready?
Yes.
So who sits where?
Oh, me.
Huh? Here.
No, no. We're going into the
To proceed there. Ah. Oh, auditorium. Very good.
Opa. You sit right here?
Yeah, very good. Тоби, я собирался тебе звонить сразу после этого выступления. Да, ты давай, не уходи, не уходи.
Thank you all for joining us. My name is Sam Karab. I'm the Senior Fellow for Russia and Eurasia at the IISS. We're honored today to be hosting three highly experienced former diplomats and negotiators from Russia to discuss international diplomatic efforts intended to address the Ukraine crisis. A paradoxical aspect of the crisis is the seeming mismatch between its severity. It is certainly the most significant threat to European security since the Cold War, and the relatively weak international diplomatic response. There have been periodic high-level phone calls, conference calls, side meetings, and summits devoted to other subjects. But the only regular mechanism in place is something called the Trilateral Contact Group, which consists of a representative of the OSCE chairperson in office, the Russian ambassador to Ukraine, and Leonid Kuchma, the former president of Ukraine, who is there in his capacity as former president of Ukraine. Compare that, the contact group established in the Balkans in the 1990s, composed of high-level representatives of the United States, the United Kingdom, France, Germany, Italy, and Russia. We have three exceptionally qualified speakers here today to address this paradox and provide recommendations on what more than policymakers today might be doing from the perspective of the major outside actors in this crisis. We're particularly honored to have Ambassador Vladimir Lukin here today. Ambassador Lukin served as Russian ambassador to the U.S. from 1992 to 1994, and as an MP in the State Duma from 2004 to 2014, he was the Human Rights Commissioner for Russia. More recently, he was the special envoy of the Russian president for the February 21st talks in Kiev between then-President Viktor Yanukovych and opposition leaders. Ambassador Richard Byrd will follow him. Ambassador Byrd was the U.S. negotiator in the strategic arms reduction talks with the Soviet Union that produced the landmark START agreement. Prior to that, he served as U.S. ambassador to Germany, assistant secretary of state for European and Canadian affairs, and director of the Political Military Affairs Bureau. From 1973 to 1977, he worked for none other than the IISS, first as a research associate, then as editor of our journal Survival, and finally as assistant director of the Institute. He's now managing director of McCarty Associates, where he leads the firm's work on Europe and Eurasia. Sir Michael Lee will follow and provide us with a European perspective. Michael is currently a Transatlantic Academy Fellow and consultant and senior advisor to the German Marshall Fund of the United States. He joined GMF after more than 30 years in EU institutions. In 2006, he became director general for enlargement of the European Commission. And prior to that, he served in a variety of capacities, including deputy director general with responsibility for European neighborhood policy, relations with Eastern Europe, South Caucasus, Central Asia, the Middle East, and the Mediterranean. And he was chief negotiator for several EU association agreements. Our three speakers today will speak for about 10 minutes per person, and then we'll open the floor to questions and discussion. So gentlemen, welcome, and thank you so much for being here today. Ambassador Lukin, the floor is yours.
I consider the fact that I am called to speak the first, as a next demonstration of inequality, not in favor of Russia. dear colleagues, actually I'm pleased to be here. after many, many, many years of discussing on this turf, Washingtonian turf, with Americans, the most important problems. Maybe you know that I was involved in Soviet and then Russian-American relations for many years, unfortunately for me. And was first Russian ambassador, post-Soviet Russian ambassador to the United States. That is why for me it is natural to overview the Russian-American relations and to come to some conclusions on it. First, I would like to acknowledge that, to my view, Russian-American relations never were so bad as they are now. And the question raises, what's the main reason? When I came here in the spring of 1992, there was a first public meeting here, not far from here. And I asked a question. Whom who was a country or problem which the United States stood for during the Cold War? It was Russia or it was communism? To put it bluntly, to put it frankly, I did not receive certain answer on this question even now. If it is Russian, I am afraid that it is very serious. It is not easier to cure this problem, because it resides in many, many, many prejudices and real problems of the distant past. As it is communism, it is much better. But in this case, some problems, some sides of behavior of the United States and the Euro-Atlantic community surprises me. I recently read a very good book. It seems to me one of the best one, of Professor Angela Stenz, which wrote recently book The Limits of Partnership. If she is not here,
she's
I am farsighted. So, taken into account that I didn't see you, and it is not typical for a colleague, you know, to praise itself. I read. I did what nobody did with books which are presented here to me. You know, I read it attentively, and she numbers four resets in our relations. Four resets. All four assets were turned by euphoria and finished by disappointment and even some irritation. What's the reason? You know, to my view, there is built in feature of Russian-American relations, over personalization, then you mentioned it, I agree. Look at it. Four resets were tightly connected with four Russian leaders: Gorbachev, Yeltsin, Putin, and Medvedev. To put aside Putin number two. These four assets were tightly connected with four American presidents: Bush, George Bush 41, Clinton, George Bush 43, and Obama. Every time there were great hopes, great euphoria, and then disappointments. So, what's the problem? I think that the big problem is that we underestimated structural, objective, as Marxists used to say, substantive parts of our relations, and overestimate personal parts. The problem, I see the problem this way. Once, when I was in the beginning of Gorbachev perestroika, I was in the United States and I visited West Coast. And before jumping into plane, I went to a marketplace to buy something, presents for family and friends and so on and so forth. And I met a lady there who worked there, kind of a shop assistant. And he asked me, he recognized that I am not American, which is very easy. And he asked me, well, where are you come from? I said, I'm from Moscow, I'm Russian. And he said, oh, Moscow, oh, Russia. I like Russia, it is so beautiful country. Russia, we have our president and Russia has president. You have parliament, Congress, and Russia has Congress. You have first lady, we have first lady, and Russia has first lady. We have to be very friendly. We look like the practically very close country. I am afraid that such feeling is very well, is very typical for many, many persons, much more sophisticated persons. But in some depths, the problem is they are sure that Russia, should be a country we perceive Russia. But America should be perceived by Russians, America should be perceived by Russia as it is, good, bad, but as it is. And it is a big difference. Russia should be ideal, America is America. She is very close to Almighty, she is special. It is a country which one of the greatest person of the world of all times, Immanuel Kant, said that chimera of excess, химера излишества. Так я правильно перевожу? They have special relations with Almighty, and that is why they have special rights. Russia is not ideal country. There are tortures in Russia, and I know it very well, because for 10 years I was Russian ombudsman. There are tortures in the United States, but it is quite different tortures. It is very positive tortures, you know, or such tortures which should be dealt within our circle. But anyway, after this, we can come to Russia and teach them how to avoid tortures. And it is a problem. And my feeling that Ukrainian problem is a part of this problem. Because ideal world is a world which repeats American big features by enlarging itself and adding to it more and more those America, which was in mind of those lady I have mentioned before, on the west coast of America. And this enlargement came to what it came, to the Russian-Ukrainian, Russian-Georgian crisis, because some substantial part of Russian elite, and more important, Russian population said, no, it wouldn't do. This way of partnership is unacceptable for us. And that is why here we are. If I stop, I think I used my time, and then I would be actively passive participate in this discussion.
Thanks. Thanks, Sam. Unlike Ambassador Lucan, I think I'm going to begin by looking at through the other end of the telescope and maybe begin on the Ukrainian problem and then generalize beyond that, maybe if time permits, to make a few random comments about U.S.-Russia relations. Is this too close or far? Is it all right? Excuse me. The first point I would make about Ukraine, and I tend to, maybe I look at this situation with a glass half full rather than half empty, but there does recently seem to have been a certain amount of improvement in terms of the situation on the ground. You have what some people are referring to this regime or silent regime, and while there are clearly still problems in implementing the Minsk Accords, there does seem to be some diminution of the Russian military presence in the Donbass. I think the estimate there is now maybe somewhere between 5 and 10,000 Russian forces, together with some irregulars. But there's talk of a so-called military freeze, and that's in a region of, I think, roughly about 3.5 million people in eastern Ukraine. There seems to be some forms of communication and cooperation between the Russian and Ukrainian military authorities in trying to stabilize the situation. And maybe here, I apologize to Angela and to Toby Gotti to be a little bit of a Sovietologist here, or what used to be called a Sovietologist. I am reliably informed that the term Novorossiya has not been used for now actually a few months in terms of statements, not only by President Putin, but other Russian leaders. And in his speech on December 4th, Vladimir Putin referred to the fraternal Ukrainian people, which is a kind of Soviet-era language, but does reflect what I think people, is being reported, Russian diplomats are talking about a new willingness of the Russian government to recognize Ukrainian territorial integrity in some form or fashion. What they're calling a single political space. So what we seem to be seeing is the formation of these, of what might be called quasi-statelets in Luhansk and Donetsk. The Russian desire for some what they call federalization or confederalization is out there as an idea. And that is usually attached to the Russian desire to see a reworked Ukrainian constitution, which would give these statelets more autonomy. So all of that seems to suggest we are not looking at this point in terms of any kind of major new escalation in the situation. Whether we're seeing the kind of emergence of a kind of frozen conflict that will be a source of dispute and disagreement for some time to come, also giving the Russians leverage over Kiev is unclear. Maybe the worst you could say at this point is that while the Russians are of course are suffering themselves economically because of lower energy prices and the sanctions and other economic problems, the Ukrainians are really suffering badly, and that maybe the Russian game plan at this point is to see this very difficult winter take place, and for the Ukrainian economy to deteriorate and potentially implode, and perhaps for the Ukrainians to come to the Russians on their knees asking for help. It's unclear, either we're seeing a stabilization in my view, or we're seeing a different, perhaps a different strategy, where Putin is prepared to let economics rather than military escalation lead to greater influence and control in Ukraine. This weekend, of course, you had the passage of the Ukrainian Freedom and Security Act by the U.S. Congress. I think we've potentially avoided what could be an inflammatory set of developments. The act, as I understand it, and I don't think the Senate and the House versions have actually been now configured. The language hasn't been entirely synchronized, but it authorizes the use of lethal American military aid, but it doesn't require it by the administration. So the administration has that option, but it's not asked to use it necessarily. Ukraine is not designated as a major non-NATO ally, which would have put Ukraine in the category of Israel, Japan, and Australia, which I don't personally think would have been a good idea at this stage in the crisis. It does institutionalize many of the sanctions that were adopted through executive order by the administration, but it gives the administration some flexibility on how it would impose those sanctions. So I assume that the president will sign the bill, but it will not fundamentally change the sanctions regime, and I think the administration's been successful in convincing the Congress that we didn't want to get too far out in front of the EU. And that allows me to remind, as we talk about the U.S.-Russia dimension of this problem, I think in looking for solutions, we should remember that this crisis really originated not between the United States and Russia, but between the United States and the European Union. And the desire of the European Union to negotiate an association agreement, and the bidding war that then took place between the EU and the Russian government over the Russian desire for Ukraine to join the so-called Eurasian Union. I think the Europeans did, in my judgment, make a mistake, given the relationship between the Ukrainian and Russian economy at the time. It did make sense, I think, for the Europeans to sit down with the Ukrainians and the Russians to talk about what the implications of European EU association would be. But that's water under the bridge. I think that a solution here, this reminds me a little bit of the Middle East problem, or the Israeli-Palestinian problem. You can find people all over Washington and elsewhere who can outline for you what a two-state solution would consist of. It's not hard to find a settlement that would seem to make sense. The problem is getting there and getting the political will to get there. Same is true, in my view, in this Ukrainian situation. I think the elements of a solution are there. I think most of the people in this room can list them. Clearly, there does need to be an element to an agreement that recognizes and gives a certain degree of local governments and governance and autonomy to the Russian-speaking populations in eastern Ukraine. There does need also to be a very strong and clear guarantee of overall Ukrainian sovereignty and self-determination. There has to be some kind of understanding about Ukraine's future alignment in the broader security architecture of Europe. And that, in my view, means that Ukraine is free to develop ties both with the European Union and with the Russian Federation. But it also means, in my view, that for the foreseeable future, Ukraine would not become a member of NATO. There are additional, I think, understandings that could be reached. For me, the question is there seems to be an inability or an unwillingness of both sides to reach that agreement. We've got a diplomatic deficit. And I try to scratch my head on occasion to wonder, ask myself why both sides have failed to come forward with ideas. It's my sense that this issue in recent months has not had a major priority within the Obama administration. That may reflect the fact that, many of the senior figures in the Obama administration don't have a background or interest in kind of classical East-West or European security issues. It may be that this administration is more transfixed with the crisis du jour, which is now, of course, instability and the threat posed by ISIS in the Middle East. It also may be that in an unspoken or unsaid way, the administration has decided to let the Europeans address this problem, mainly in the form of asking Berlin to take the lead in finding a solution. And I think it's well known that any of the Western leaders that have addressed this problem, Angela Merkel has talked repeatedly with Vladimir Putin about this issue. It's not clear to me to what extent that she has felt that she has the ability to kind of work on some of these elements of what would be a solution here. And it may well also be that the Russian side, hoping that they can play for time, that their regional military superiority coupled with the crisis, the economic crisis in Ukraine, and Ukraine's persistent inability to reform its own economy and to come to grips with corruption should lead the Russians not to, at this stage, make any important concessions and compromises, believing that in the end they will end up as the dominant power. I don't have the answers to that that question, but I will say, just in closing, that that I don't disagree with Ambassador Lucan on the degree to which American exceptionalism has perhaps created problems in the broader U.S.-Russia dialogue. I will note, however, if one reads President Trump's December 4th speech to the Federal Assembly, that there are a lot of elements of what I would call Russian exceptionalism creeping into the Russian narrative, which will only make that process more difficult as time goes by. One last statement is one, I think the Russians are continuing to talk about security architecture in Europe. And I think this is not a new idea. President Medvedev, when he was president, I think raised this idea several years ago. I don't agree with some people at Brookings who recently argued that, well, we should think about NATO not having a role in Europe any longer. It should be an out-of-area institution. I don't accept that. NATO still has, obviously, in my view, an important role to play in terms of European security going forward. But it doesn't have an exclusive role to play in terms of European security going forward. I was a little bit surprised 4 or 5 years ago when Medvedev raised this idea that Europeans and the Americans didn't take a harder look at this issue, and maybe in the process of trying to reach a diplomatic settlement on Ukraine, we can start being a little more creative and thinking organizationally and institutionally about European security in a broader geographical context.
Thank you, Rick. Michael?
Well, thank you, Sam. I'm not sure if gratified is the word, but when I heard Ambassador Lukin's presentation and noted that he did not mention the European Union, I thought, well, at least we're not part of the problem. But Rick has, in fact, recalled.
When you admit us, we will mention it.
Okay. Rick has recalled that indeed the European Union has played a role in the course of events in Ukraine and Russia. And as a former EU official, I would like to recall just a couple of details of this, because there's a narrative which the ambassador did touch on in the US context when he spoke about expansion or enlargement of the US presence or the NATO presence. But part of the Russian narrative to explain events is also about expansion of the EU and the perception, at least, that it's been the goal of the EU to expand into an area that some in Russia at least perceive as their sphere of influence, and that the course of events to some extent flows from that. I noted just today a report that Prime Minister Medvedev has just commented that he doesn't think that the European Union will be open to Ukrainian membership. Well, thank you very much. I could have told him that before the whole sequence of events began. And if that had been perceived in Moscow 2 or 3 years ago, perhaps it's our fault. Perhaps there's a communication issue here. Perhaps, as Rick said, one should have engaged more intensively in a discussion with Russia about our common neighborhood. But just to recall extremely briefly a couple of points. First of all, the association agreement that was mentioned was negotiated and devised first and foremost from an EU perspective to prevent Ukraine from applying for membership in the European Union. After accession of Poland and 10 other countries in 2004 and Romania and Bulgaria in 2007, there was no appetite whatsoever, and there is not today, as has been confirmed by the new Commission President Juncker, to see a further expansion of the European Union within the conceivable future. And the association agreement was conceived of as an alternative to membership. And one of Mr. Yanukovych's problem, or alleged problems with it, in the period when it looked as though he was reflecting on whether or not to sign, was the argument, or at least the pretext, that it did not offer a membership perspective to Ukraine. To be sure, some in the European Union, particularly in Sweden, in Poland, in the Baltic states, would have been ready to offer such a perspective to Ukraine. But the EU as a whole, 28 member states, never did. And enlargement fatigue had taken over. And the very thought of biting off a chunk of Europe as problematic and as large as Ukraine would have been the most negative thought for all member states. That's point number one. The EU did not aim for membership for Ukraine. Point number two, the narrative that the European Union was somehow or other asking Ukraine to choose between Moscow and Brussels, also completely misleading. The ambassador didn't make that point today, but it has been made and it entered in the narrative, and perhaps the Europeans were not active enough in countering it. But the association agreement, as negotiated, was entirely compatible with Ukraine's existing free trade agreement with Russia in the CIS context. It was not compatible with the Eurasian Customs Union, to be sure. But it was compatible with Ukraine's existing FTA with Russia. So when this process began, way back in 2003-2004, the EU also suggested negotiations of a new partnership with Russia. Russia wanted a strategic partnership with the EU, And basically, we spent 10 years trying to negotiate such an agreement. But there was no meeting of minds, and Russia's view of this relationship was not the same as that held by the member states. And these negotiations, in the end, proved fruitless. Nonetheless, the EU supported Russia's application to join the World Trade Organization. And in fact, on exactly the day when Cathy Ashton signed for the EU's agreement on Russia's accession to the WTO, the Eurasian Customs Union was launched, which in some respects is incompatible with Russia's WTO commitment. So I think, you know, sometimes the EU should be taken at its word. It is very largely a kind of technocratic organization. The goal proclaimed 10 years ago vis-a-vis Eastern Europe was that EU basically wanted a neighborhood where there would not be problems stemming from organized crime and corruption and other problems spilling over into the EU. The EU basically wanted to strengthen security and stability along its borders. And this was really the goal in coming up with the association agreement, and no more than that. The EU also took at its word the fact that Ukraine is a sovereign state, is recognized as such by all international organizations, countries around the world, and that if it seemed as though different Ukrainian governments wished to enter into this kind of negotiation with the EU, the EU was ready to do this. And the goal was essentially to support, and remains to support, modernization and development in Ukraine in the hope that the country will be stable and will not be a black hole, basically, on the EU's border. That is something that would cause concern. Now, when the series of events that we're all only too familiar with began, I mean, how broadly speaking has the EU reacted? It was most reluctant to be drawn into the sanctions story, as you know. Germany, to begin with 6,000 German companies involved in Russia, was most reluctant to join the United States in imposing sanctions. And it was only the shooting down of the Malaysian plane that I think crystallized the decision for Mrs. Merkel. And it really seemed in Europe as though there was no alternative. I mean, given the annexation of Crimea and the series of events that we are all aware of, and the threat that they seemed to pose to the prevailing norms in Europe, that there was no alternative to take this step. It was clear from the outset that there would not be a military response as such. At the same time, the EU has really engaged with Ukraine, and I do think sometimes this needs to be taken at face value and not regarded as a part of some kind of plot to help the new government that has been elected through another round of elections that are broadly considered to have been free and fair to implement a reform program. And today, the EU has 40 officials or so involved with the government on such issues as fight against corruption, reform of the taxation regime, trying to end Naftogaz's monopoly, trying to phase out energy subsidies, putting into place a social safety net for the poorest who will be hit most by withdrawal of the subsidies, and a whole range of reforms necessary for the country to become a functional and modern state and not a failed state, which is something that the EU is basically looking for. Now, when Russia indicated that it had some concerns about the association agreement, particularly about the deep and comprehensive free trade agreement, DCFTA as it's called, that accompanied this, the EU formed a trilateral group with Ukraine and with Russia to look into the consequences of the DCFTA for Russia. For some period, Russia discontinued its participation in this group, but recently has indicated its desire to continue this conversation. Now, in all these discussions so far, there has not been identified a single area in which the DCFTA will pose negative economic consequences for Russia. We know there's a whole narrative about the displacement of cheap Ukrainian goods onto the Russian market and so on. The EU has been willing to look into all these issues. And if I can just express a personal view, I do think that if some areas were discovered as having negative consequences for Russia, there would probably be an openness to having a look at least at transitional periods and so on, possibly extending them, not reopening the negotiations on the treaty itself to attenuate those effects. What else has the EU been up to recently? Well, as you know, the EU brokered these trilateral talks between Ukraine and Russia, which led to a winter fuel deal that has guaranteed that at least in the period through to March, there'll be no crisis of the discontinuation of energy supplies to Ukraine and then from Ukraine on into Europe. During the difficult period before this agreement was reached, the EU also supported reverse flows from Slovakia, and for a while before Hungary got cold feet, from Hungary to Ukraine again to prevent blackouts during the winter. So I think in a rather technocratic way, and then of course we also have the support for the IMF bailout agreement and funding for Ukraine. So. The EU has done what it could during this difficult period to try and stabilize the situation and to encourage the authorities in Ukraine to pursue a genuine reform strategy. And we don't underestimate at all the magnitude of the challenge and all the problems within the country that need to be overcome. Where do we go from here? I think the more political negotiations clearly are being conducted by some of the EU's member states, not by the EU institutions as such. I think if we can build on the Minsk agreement, if the present relative calm that Rick referred to can lead to a more long-term de-escalation, if in the end there can be some kind of understanding between Ukraine and Russia along the lines that Rick mentioned, including elements of decentralization that I think would be of great interest also in the west of the country and throughout Ukraine. In the west, for example, they really see themselves developing a technological capacity, a Silicon Valley outside Lviv. I think they'd be only too happy to move towards some kind of confederal or federal arrangement. The EU is ready to advise on constitutional issues, based on the situation in some of our own member states as well, the importance of Russian as an official language. And if there is a general de-escalation, if the situation develops in such a way that there can be an exit at some point from the sanctions regime, I think it's quite apparent that the European Union would be ready to engage with Russia, both in a dialogue about our common neighborhood, and even, which until now has not been really on the table, the possibility at some stage of the EU engaging with the Eurasian Customs Union, which has been very consciously based in its structures on at least the economic aspects of the European Union. So the EU then has been a reluctant partner in the sanctions, but one that felt in the end that there was no choice. The EU over a 10-year period has sought to engage with Russia, supported Russia's WTO membership, and on the whole would like to see Russia becoming a more active part of the rules-based international system. The policy towards Ukraine has not been based on enlargement, expansion, encroachment on what Russia perceives as its sphere of influence, but rather on support for the Ukrainians' own desire for modernization and development. And this remains the picture. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you.
To all three of you. Before we open it up, I'll take the first question. Ambassador McKeon. Ambassador Byrd laid out a vision for how this conflict might end. He described a number of elements that might be part of a solution. I'm not going to get into the details again, but I wanted to know what your reaction was to that and how what your vision is for how the conflict how the crisis might come to an end, or how it should come to an end.
Well, I have a feeling that something is stirring, something is going on already. I think that my intuition tells me. First, I would like to underline that I am a private citizen, and what I am telling now, it is no more than my private view. Yes, as a matter of fact, I was asked by President for two times to visit different part of Ukraine and to deal different things. In February to participate in talks, and in May to try to set free people from OSCE who were kept in Slavyansk. And in first attempt was less than successful, second was successful. I'm not so cruel to say that I would prefer things vice versa, you know. something is beginning to come to the more reasonable way to negotiations. My intuition tells me that there are more talks now behind the surface, behind the official proclamations, exclamations, and so on and so forth. And tone of criticism has begun to somehow to get diminished, I would say. But it is an environment as far as substance is concerned. Well, of course, important things should be done. The strict fulfillment of Minsk talks should be very important. To the best of my knowledge, now there is one thing has been done. How firmly and how irreversibly it remains to be seen. I mean, there is no military actions now. It is the most important single thing. And I hope that it will be kept up by both sides. Behind this, there are many difficult struggle, internal struggle on one side and on the other side. I mean Donetsk, and more broader than Donetsk, on what to do next. And since nothing is being done next, it is very positive. And that is why I only pray that Minsk agreement should be fulfilled, and it is of course important. Then many difficult problems begins, and those difficult problems are divided in my view, on two parts. Such problems which could be resolved, and such problems which is impossible to imagine how they could be resolved by now. And first is how to drag away both parts to strengthen peace situation of no military actions. It is important, and it is not easy, because both under the general leadership of Kyiv, there are many ambitious half-independent units. And same thing exists on the Donetsk and Lugansk sense. And how to deal with them, it is easier to discuss here than to discuss behind the carpet, I would say. It is a big problem. But I am absolutely sure that it happens. I don't know, but I am absolutely sure that it happens. And it is very difficult, the most difficult and most important feature now. Secondly, about, I say a few words about those problems which could be resolved and those which could be resolved. First, a bunch of problems are technical existence in peaceful atmosphere, development of trade, development of normal exchanges on both sides, development of social outlays from Kyiv to Donetsk and with some possible participation of Russian side and talks about this bunch of problems. The problems of access of everything to Crimea now, and so on and so forth. And it makes this 1001 problems are very difficult and very lengthy. The second, of course, there should be done many things on Kyiv side to legally guarantee the federal or autonomous existence of Donetsk and Lugansk areas. And there should be pressure to move them more negotiable. And this pressure is being felt by everybody who looks at it attentively. All these problems should be done, but it can be done very swiftly. I think it would be a lot of problems on every stages. Secondly, there are problems which cannot be resolved now. About these problems, I remember the great Deng Xiaoping words. He said about border problems between China and Japan, between China and Korea, and so on and so forth. He said, well, let us try to resolve what we can. And if we cannot, let us give this problem, let them be inherited by next generation. And next generation, maybe next generation will become more wise than ourselves and find ways to resolve this problem. I, as a private citizen, I tell you frankly, I don't know any political situation, internal political situation in Russia, which gives to anybody, any government in Moscow, opportunity to stir again Crimean problem. I don't think so. Maybe Boris Nemtsov will become a head of a Russian government. Even he will be unable to do something like this. On the other hand, I recognize that Kyiv, under all circumstances, will not recognize the new reality. By new reality, I mean Crimea, of course. In this situation, what to do? To try to convince each other and to stimulate each other to be convinced that one side is right and another side is wrong? Or to use the formula of Deng Xiaoping? That is basically my understanding of this situation.
Thank you very much. Now we'll open the floor for questions. Over here. Please wait for the microphone, and before you ask your question, please give your name and affiliation.
I'm a proponent of equality. The next question is not to me, but my colleagues, I think.
Who did you call on me?
Over here.
Thanks, Sam. I'm Jeff Mankoff with the Center for Strategic and International Studies, and I will commit to equality by asking a question primarily from Michael Lee. I largely agree with Ambassador Burt's analysis that one piece of the Russian strategy seems to be to let the economic troubles in Ukraine take their toll and see if at some point a kind of fatigue sets in on the part of the Europeans and the United States. Already there's been a fairly substantial amount of money that's been put into Ukraine on the part of the IMF, on the part of the EU, and to a lesser degree on the part of the U.S.
Correct.
But despite that, Ukraine still has these very serious economic problems. I know the IMF estimated about $19 billion additionally could be needed. The figure I've seen more recently is a little bit lower, but it's still well north of $10 billion. And that being the case, I guess my question is, what is the debate in Europe? How much willingness is there to commit that kind of additional financial resources to Ukraine to prevent the kind of economic collapse that Ambassador Burt warned about?
I think the Europeans are taking it step by step, and they haven't really debated at this stage their willingness to contribute another 15 billion euro, whatever it may be, to a second bailout package. And they're concentrating more on the short term. And there is a lot of technical assistance, financial assistance going in, but not enough to save the country next spring, for example, from a possible default. That's clear. And there will be reluctance to come up with this kind of funding. It won't be easy at all. But if you ask me to make an educated guess, I think when push comes to shove, if there's another IMF package mooted to which the international community in general are indirectly contributing, I think the EU will not want to see Ukraine go under.
Yeah, Bill Jones, Executive Intelligence Review. I'd like to just ask about what Ambassador Burt commented on, Ambassador Lukin's comments saying that he was placing the blame on the West, that the crisis had occurred. And it's generally understood or generally said here that the Russians are a little too paranoid about what the West was doing and overreacted. But if you look at what happened over the last few years in terms of the expansion of NATO right to the border of Russia, I think anybody looking at the situation from here or from Russia would begin to get a little bit worried about where things were going. And then when the Ukrainian situation developed and you had a general move to overthrow the elected leaders, you had Toria Nuland going in there passing out cookies to help the process a little bit. It seemed to me, and it was clear at the State Department when these questions came up, that it seemed to be a little bit of overkill. This was not business as usual. And I think to neglect the fact that the Russians have reacted, I think, rationally to what was more extreme and aggressive policy on the part of the West, I think is missing the point entirely. And if you'd like to comment on that again, you can do so. And Ambassador Lukin, I think, was correct in his estimates here.
Well, I think rather than to call Western policy extreme and aggressive, as you just put it, I think I'd probably be tempted to maybe call it more befuddled. First of all, I don't disagree with Michael's excellent description of the EU piece of this and the way they approach this problem. But I also agree with those in Europe who also say that this was handled in a kind of bureaucratic fashion. Never, the whole Eastern Partnership, for a variety of reasons, was never given the kind of strategic importance that it should have been received from senior people, both in capitals and in Brussels. So, I think there were some mistakes there. There were certainly mistakes on the U.S. side. They began, in my judgment, at the 2008 Bucharest summit, when you had a Bush administration who came into town wanting to get both Ukraine and Georgia admitted to NATO. Mrs. Merkel stopped the Bush administration from jumping off the cliff at that point, and but that led then to agreement to language that somehow convinced some people that Ukraine was going to continue to be a candidate for membership and so on. And so it's never been clear to me whether I hear different stories, whether Toria Nuland was handing out buns or cookies or what she was handing out. It is interesting to me, though, and that for me, as somebody pointed out as a former journalist, that famous leak, which was apparently collected by the Russian security services or whatever, that got so much attention from her phone call with Ambassador Pyatt, was what people in Washington and Europe focused on was her language in describing the European Union, and that got all the attention. But what that wasn't, in my view, the purpose of the leak. The purpose of the leak was her discussion with the ambassador about all of this sort of wheeling and dealing about who was going to make up the new Ukrainian government, because what the Russians wanted to portray was, here are the Americans, those evil people working behind the scenes, trying to manipulate this new Ukrainian government. This is where you get a real clash of narratives. We in Washington are besotted with this sort of notion of young people using Twitter and social media, bringing down authoritarian governments and power to the people. And whether it doesn't matter whether it's in Tahrir Square or in Tripoli or in Kiev. And the Russians, of course, their narrative was this was a coup engineered by the Americans and their NATO allies. And until or unless, it seems to me that we're able to be a lot to develop a little more sophisticated political dialogue amongst ourselves, we're going to have this clash of narratives and this creation of myths, of political myths on both sides of the dialogue.
So we have time for one more question. Someone caught my eye before these hands went up. I apologize. In the front row. And then I'll give all three of our panelists an opportunity to respond. Angela, yes.
Thank you. Angela Sten, Georgetown University. Thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador, for your kind words about my book. I had a question for you. I agree with you that there are some issues that cannot be solved and may be solved by the next generation. We talked about Crimea, but I wanted to ask you about the situation that Ambassador Burt described, which is the developing frozen conflict in the Donbas region, where it's going to make it almost impossible for the government in Kiev to establish its control over the whole of its territory. Do you think that this is also going to be an issue for the next generation? Do you see this going on for years?
Well, when I spoke about next generation, the Crimean idea, I mean generation after my son. And this I mean after myself. I think that beside very special history with Crimea, I don't want to discuss this history of this to begin with Ottoman Empire and the Crimean Khans and so on and so forth, and where was legal, what was illegal. I put aside it. I will say what I said about Crimea, I stick to it. As far as beside Crimea, I did not hear from our government that they do not recognize the territorial integrity and sovereignty of Ukraine. It is absolutely clear, and it is repeated from time to time, from speech to speech. That is why I recognize that this problem should be resolved, and should be resolved by patiently, without any rush, but consistently. And I think this process has begun now, with all difficulties, including internal policy difficulties. That is my understanding, my personal understanding of the situation. I would like to comment a little on what my colleague, friend and neighbor just said. You know, it is another what I repeated Kant as a excess, as a chimera of excess. It is very difficult. Of course, Russia is a great power. Don't exclude it from this illness, I would say. But look at this situation from the last year and the beginning of this year from the Moscow angle, from the Moscow, from the Red Square. And you see that Yanukovych, very questionable president, of course, is legitimate president of Ukraine, recognized as legitimate by everybody, including governments of persons who sit here. And he conduct their very contradictory policy, but everybody recognize him. And when Maidan has begun, there are talks on how to tackle this problem with legitimacy and so on and so forth. Some talks has begun, and there was a basic agreement which was fixed up and initiated by myself, among others, in Kyiv on February of 21, that there will be a process of election by December of this year, by the way, this month, and process of re-elections, process of amendments in the constitution, return to constitution of 2004, and so on and so forth. Many things. Legitimate, agreed upon, and so on and so forth. At the same time, Moscow authorities see that foreign minister of European Union, high authorities of the United States come to Kyiv, go to Maidan, and say, well, long live revolutionary Maidan and revolutionary government, and go away illegitimate Yanukovych and all others. What is it? What does it mean? How to act vis-a-vis this one? Putin calls me one evening and asks me to go and to participate in talks which would legitimize somehow. We agreed with three other foreign ministers agreement, and I initiated it in the evening. And then I, of course, reported to Moscow, and they thought a lot and think, are you sure that it will be fulfilled? It will be complied with? I said, no, discussions with Yanukovych in the intervals and others, I cannot swear solemnly that it will be fulfilled. Okay? So, final decision after certain hesitations were not to sign it, because there is no guarantees. And what happened on the next morning? Maidan occupied residence of Yanukovych. Yanukovych ran away despite all our advice. I assure you that there was advices, because one advice came from me to stay and to comply with this agreement. My two friends of that night, Mr. Yatsenyuk, Mr. Tikhonyuk and Mr. Klitschko, which is the most dangerous single person, of course. They said, well, we are ready for everything, but to not to Maidan and to say that and to say in favor of this agreement, because they will be acting revolutionary way, and they were right. Yatsenyuk spoke and he lost his popularity temporarily because he tried to advocate this agreement. What happens? How Moscow had to react on this? It was an illegitimate revolution, openly and visibly, televisibly supported by leaders of the United States, very important persons. No criticism about Victoria Nuland in my presence, I ask you, because she was a younger officer of our embassy who helped me to collect my belongings and to go to the United States in my capacity of ambassador. I personally attached to her. But actually, it was demonstration of that real rules of game, a real confidence talks by on the telephone and so on. When I came to our president, he called on the telephone with Chancellor Merkel, and I waited a lot because I don't speak German, unfortunately. That is why situation was absolutely strange and absolutely don't deserve any confidence to anybody. In this situation happened what has happened. My personal opinion that decision to act in Crimea was adopted in the last minute. Of course, maybe some worst case scenario were elaborated. I don't know. I am not participating in all this. But when I prepared to fly in the rush to Kyiv, there were no such things. I never heard them. That is, excuse me for my long intervention.
For the sake of equality, then, we'll have given you the last word, Ambassador Lukin, today.
Last word? And where I should be executed? I forgot that I'm in the country where capital punishment is not abrogated. Not.
Thank you for that reminder. Thank you. Thanks to all three of our panelists for a very similar discussion.
Well done.
Thank you. Thank you.